spend the next 60 minutes outlining what I think is the future of the industry and, to a very large extent, your career. Ali already gave a few words on my background. Here's a whole slide on it. I've been a software architect my entire career. For the last 20 years, I founded and ran a company called IDesign, devoted for the sole purpose of doing nothing but software design. And we've helped hundreds of companies all over the world use our techniques and meet their commitments. In my masterclasses, I've launched the careers of thousands of architects the world over. Before IDesign, in the late 90s, I was the chief software architect of a Fortune 100 company in Silicon Valley. Before that, I was a division architect. Before that, I was a project architect. Before that, I was just an architect. I'm at the beginning of my fourth decade as an architect. I published 8 books. The latest one is called Writing Software. It was published just before the whole Corona nonsense started. I've published more than 100 articles on my ideas and technique. I speak at conferences all over the world. I never worked for Microsoft, but I was privileged to be part of the strategic design effort of C-Sharp and later on WCF. Microsoft recognized me as a software legend, something they only gave to 6 people so far due to the impact they've had on the industry over the years. And you get a hint of my impact today. And so let's talk about the current state of the industry. In a nutshell, it's not going very well. The industry is in a deep crisis. And what makes this crisis so acute is that every aspect of software development is broken. Deadline means nothing for software developers. Deadline has these useless things that somebody at management or marketing commits to, and you're just working on your keyboard and they just whoosh by. Nobody cares. In fact, if you meet a deadline, everybody's going to be surprised because the expectation is for you to always miss the deadline. Cost doesn't mean anything. If you ask the software development organization how much it costs to develop the software, you're going to get a blank stare. Developers are going to tell you, well, nobody can answer that question. We're going to have to build it to know how much it will cost. Tell me something. How can you run a business when time and money do not matter? You couldn't operate a hot dog stand if time and money did not matter. And people are trying to run viable businesses. It's madness. Requirements is broken. Developers often solve the wrong thing. The customer wanted something. Developers develop some interpretation of what they feel is required. There's no correlation. Quality is out of control. Software is so rife with defects that the word bugs is synonymous with software. Now, if I were to tell you that every software product I was involved in, I shipped on schedule, on budget, with zero defects, what would be your reaction? Most people would write me off as a liar because that's obviously impossible. And I don't know what offended you more the most, the fact that I met the schedule or the fact that I had no defects. Staffing is broken. Quite often, the software is not maintained in perpetuity by the people that wrote it. And there's an enormous gap between developers. Sometimes it can be 10 times, 100 times better than other developers. So now what happens is you have really smart developers writing code and they can handle the complexity, but then they hand it off to some maintenance team and those guys can't make sense of it. And as a result, they always make it worse and they introduce defects when they try and introduce, when they try and solve new requirements. And every few years, they have to do a clean slate and do it all over again because the current staff just throws a hand in the air and so we can't take it anymore. Now, I know I'm painting with a broad brush here, but hardly anybody's doing it right. Yes, every once in a while, you find somebody's doing it right, but by and large, this is symptomatic of the entire industry. Now, whenever you have a multidimensional crisis, you can't have a one-trick pony. You can't have a magic wand that fixes everything. When you have a multidimensional crisis, you need a multidimensional solution. You need something that addresses the system design issues, the project design issue, the process design issue, the tools, even the careers of the people involved. And obviously in 60 minutes today, I'm not going to show you that I have a magic bullet for it all. In fact, what we will see today is that I don't even think we have all the pieces yet required to solve this. But the way the industry is going to solve it is going to have profound implication, especially on your own livelihood, on what you do for a living. And I guess the message out of this webcast today is to take a long, hard look at the rest of your career and say how you need to align it with what's coming. So let's start with an overview of what software development should have looked like and why. It's a very traditional, classical view, what I'm going to show you next. You need to write some kind of a requirement document. And the reason is that you need to have some kind of a system design. And the reason we need to invest in design is for the long term. If a software has a lifespan of a few minutes, we don't care about architecture. But architecture is how we get the system to be maintainable, extensible, reusable. Well, all of these attributes are long term. Nobody cares about maintenance next week. You care about maintenance 7 or 10 years from now. Well, how could anybody maintain your code if they don't understand it? The fundamental reason people introduce bugs and make the problem even worse is they don't understand the working of the code or the working of the system. So you need to write a design document. What's the project overview? What are we here for? What's the business model? What's the operational concept? Any kind of assumption. We never do this. We always do that. How about documenting the services, the interfaces? The second parameter for the force method on the second interface is an int. And here's the allowable values. And here's what happened if it's not in that range. And on and on and on. And there'll be some kind of sample code. Here's how you start up a service. Here's how you shut down a service. Here's how you abort an operation in progress. Here's how you reconcile things going out of order. All of these things is very, very difficult to infer by looking at the code. In fact, it's been measured that there's an enormous ROI on SDD because without the design document, developers are going to spend hundreds and thousands of hours trying to figure out, and maybe they can't figure it out, versus just reading a page, which takes a minute. And so you need to document your code. Separately from that, there's the world of requirements. It may come to you as a complete shock to learn that most people are doing it wrong. Most people capture the requirements in a functional way. They capture the required functionality of the system. And if they even bother to write a requirement spec, it would read like this. 1.2.3 system should do A. 4.5.6 system should do B. This is a functional requirement, and this is a horrible way of doing it. And the reason is developers don't deal with required functionality. Developers provide code which is required behavior. So it's much better to capture the required behavior of the system, not the required functionality. The risk you run here is that if you only talk about required functionality, developers are going to have to interpret what is the required behavior of the system to support the functionality. And now you run the risk of them misinterpreting. And Murphy says they're always going to misinterpret. So you want to have the requirements not open for interpretation. So you want to capture the required behavior in the form of a use case. Note, I'm not saying a user story. I'm talking about a use case. And the reason is user stories tend to be very, very user-centric. In most systems today, what the user sees is the tip of the iceberg. Most of the system is below the waterline. Case in point, Google. Are you telling me Google is just a search box and a button? Well, that's what the user sees, but is this really all that Google is? A use case is far more from a system perspective. Here's some required behavior. It could be open for the user, could be some back-end system that nobody sees. In a use case, you capture the steps, the logic, the conditions, the pre and post condition required in a behavior. The best way of capturing a use case is graphically. And the reason is nobody reads anything. Sure, you can type a use case, but then nobody reads anything. And the reason nobody reads anything is because reading is very artificial to the human brain. We've only been reading for less than 5,000 years. And so there isn't a single neuron in your brain devoted for reading. Reading is completely artificial for the brain. On the other hand, half your brain is a giant video processing card. And so image processing is literally doing hardware. So you want to capture it graphically. The best way of capturing it graphically is in activity diagrams. Now, most people, even if they bother to capture required behavior, they do some kind of a flowchart. Flowchart is a horrible way of capturing required behavior because flowchart has no notion of time. How do you show in flowchart concurrent execution? How do you show blocking waiting for something to happen? There is no notion of time in a flowchart. Now, time is paramount in required behavior. And so never use flowcharts. Instead, you should use activity diagrams. And you can see on the screen a simple activity diagram. You don't have to know anything about the notation to see that something is happening. And then the system blocks waiting for some event to happen. And after that event, three things are happening concurrently. So you want to capture it graphically. Now, when you capture things graphically, it's a lot of work to prepare those diagrams. And a decent system could have 100, 200, 300 of these use cases. Should you capture them all graphically? Well, if you have the time, sure. But my rule of thumb, by the way, is a nested if. Whenever you have a nested if, you must capture it graphically. And the reason, if you capture it textually, no human can pass a sentence with a nested if. System should do this, and then it does that. But if this happened, you should do that, and this, oh, you just lost the reader on a second if. Nobody can pass that sentence. But graphically, you can easily see 17 nested ifs, no problem at all, and it's not open for interpretation. In fact, if you have a complex textual use case, you always see the reader taking pencil and paper, doodling on the side, trying to visualize what you're calling for. So you know what? If they're trying to visualize, give them the visualization in the first place. It's much better. And so you need to capture those required behaviors in the form of graphical use cases. Now, separately complete from requirements is architecture. Architecture is always and everywhere an act of decomposition. You have a big nebulous idea of what the system should do or what it should look like, and then you break it down into a series of components, modules, services, building blocks, classes, whatever the granularity is, it doesn't really matter. You decompose into these building blocks, and that is your architecture. The question is, how do you know the architecture is any good? One option is build a system, invest all the time in building it, and then see if the design was okay. Now, I'm sure you could actually do it. In fact, many people try and do systems this way. The problem is, this is the most expensive way of validating the design. Why? Because you've already spent the effort building the system. Now, in the physical world, nobody would ever try and qualify a design by building the system. For example, suppose you're trying to design a house, and you build a single-family home house, you show it to the customer. You like it, the customer says, no, I want two floors. You destroy the building, build the second floor. You like it now? Well, I like the second floor, but where's the kitchen? Ah, you wanted the kitchen. So every time you're trying to find out what was the right design of building the entity is the most expensive way of doing it. There is a far cheaper way of doing it, which is design validation. You could draw a set of interaction diagrams. So you have some kind of a candidate for your architecture, a set of building blocks, a decomposition, and you now try and arrange the blocks to support a required behavior. Now, if you can generate this kind of interaction for every one of your use cases, you have a valid design. Now, I didn't say it's a great design. I said it's a valid design. Any one of the use cases you can support, it's a valid design. It turns out that, I know it looks like it's more work to do it besides just coding. Generating these diagrams and validating the design like this is a fraction of a fraction of the cost of doing it in code. It's probably 1% of 1%, meaning 1/10,000 or something. It's a ridiculously low amount of energy compared to doing it in code. And now before the emotion, before the stress, you get to qualify your design. You get to see if it's gonna hold water or not. This is the responsible engineered approach for validating the design. The overall flow of the process in software development should look like this. Every software development effort has two sides to it. It's got the business domain, it's got the software domain. In the business domain, things start with some kind of marketing requirements. These marketing requirements are some kind of requirements that the end customers express to marketing or the product managers or business analysts. Typically, you cannot work against these marketing requirements. There has to be an act of deriving the real requirements you're going to work for. And here's why. Suppose the customer asks for the moon. Can you give the customer the moon? The answer is no. But you know what? If the customer is going to go for Swiss cheese, maybe you should give them Swiss cheese. So the real requirement now is Swiss cheese. It's not the moon. In addition, there's many times that software development organization develop things that no customer ever asked for. What if you're doing something that will help you in another project? What if you're doing something that opens up new market possibilities? You know, Henry Ford used to say that if he listened to his customers, all they would want is a faster horse. And so they're always an act of derived requirements. Now, the Venn diagram is a lot of overlap. But there are things in the marketing requirements which are not in derived requirements, and there are things in derived requirements which are not in the marketing requirements. Now, even the derived requirements are still highly functional. There's then the act of converting those into actual required behaviors, hopefully in the form of graphical activity diagrams. Now, all of that is in the business world. In the software world, we have two subdomains. We have a static aspect of the system, a dynamic aspect of the system. A classic static aspect is your architecture. I've got layers inside layers, I've got components, modules, services, classes, it doesn't matter what, I've got the building blocks. But that is a fairly static view of the system. It's like an X-ray of the system. It doesn't tell me how those things interact at runtime. The SDD, the software design document, is also fairly static. The second parameter for the force method is an integer. Okay, that's fairly static. The interaction diagram I showed you a slide ago are dynamic. They show how the various parts of the system are designed to interact at runtime. That's a very dynamic view. Now, what is code? Code is the act of marrying the STD to the interaction diagram. In fact, you can take a developer, give them a set of interaction diagram, give them a set of description in the STD, and you simply say, look, give me this using that. Give me the interaction diagrams using the STD. Done. That's basically what coding is. Now, this is the finished product. It never actually starts this way. This is a highly iterative process. Why? Because on day one of the project, first of all, nobody ever gives you all the requirements, and you don't have the right architecture to begin with. And so you basically iterate over here. You have some notion of what the architecture could look like, and you have some set of requirements. So now what you try and do, you try and match the requirements that you have using the building blocks. And then you say, no, this, I can't do it, but if I split that block in two, then now I can actually do this use case because I've got this for that and that for this. So you basically factor your design by trying to validate it against the requirements. And it's a highly iterative process. Now, it's very obvious to see that the requirements affect the architecture. It's a lot less obvious, but it's just as true that the architecture affects the requirements. For example, suppose I give you two requirements, 1.2.3 and 4.5.6, and these two requirements result in exactly the same interaction diagram. Now, what they actually gave you here is a duplicate requirements, which is very common. The marketing guy talks to one customer and they describe something in their vernacular, they put it in the requirements spec. You go and talk to another customer, describe in their vernacular what something which is totally different to them, but in fact, it's exactly the same thing. And you may even go back to marketing and say, look, you gave me these two things, but they're actually the same. I'm only doing one of them. Which one do you want me to do? And they say, well, we never thought about it this way, but okay, let's do 1.2.3. You just made the requirement disappear. What if they give you two requirements and you can do requirement A, but then you cannot do requirement B? Now, you could, by the way, do B, but then you cannot do A. What you have here is mutually exclusive requirements. One customer wants it black, the other customer wants it white. Now, I can do either one, but I can't do both. What you discovered here is mutually exclusive requirements. Now, what do you do now? You can go back to marketing and say, look, we've got the mutually exclusive requirements here. Now, if they're any good, by the way, at this point, they would say, let me get back to you on that one. And the reason is, suppose we have 10 customers, 9 want to do an A, and the 10th wants to do a B. Now, before you say, let's do an A, what if A pays the bills today, but B is the future of the business? Now, I don't know how you're going to resolve it, nor do I actually care. The reason is, the way you resolve it is always in the business domain, it's not in the software domain. Now, you could also sometimes put your components in such a way that cannot be traced back to any requirement. You can take that back to marketing and say, would you like me to do that? And they may say, well, I never thought about it this way. So yes, of course. I mean, if of course, you just created new requirements. So the requirements affects the architecture affects the requirement. You go back and forth here. Eventually the dust settles and you have this finished product as you see here. Now, I've been talking for almost 20 minutes now, and I show you this nice diagram, and every single one of you had the following train of thoughts. And your thinking was like this. You all said, yes, of course, this is wonderful. This is structured. This is repeatable. This is good. And I can't say anything bad about it. This is motherhood and apple pie. Except we cannot do it. I mean, maybe everybody else can do it. Maybe in California they can do it, but we cannot do it. And you wrote me off as a coup, as some kind of a weirdo that talks about things that never work. And you basically compiled a list of excuses in your head and a list of reasons why you cannot do what I just proposed. Now, everybody else could try and do it. You cannot do it. And that's fine that you cannot do it, you said to yourself. And the reason you all wrote me off is because of something that you, over the years, have learned to call the curse, with a capital C. And there's many versions of the curse, but if I try and abstract away the curse, your curse looks like this. You say, look, I'd love to do what you do here. This is motherhood and apple pie. You can't say anything bad about motherhood and apple pies. But the problem is the requirements. The requirements, they keep changing it on me. And I'd love to do this iterative process you describe here and figure all of these things. But the time it takes me to loop around here and figure things out is much longer than the time it takes them to change the requirements on me. And therefore, I cannot actually do this. And therefore, and everybody knows you cannot do this, and therefore, you're full of it, and we don't have to listen to you anymore. Well, let's pass that declaration that it's a curse and you can't do it. Do you think it's just you? You think that you're the one that's cursed? Everybody else has a sunny sky. You have a curse. It's like a thunderstorm cloud raining hail and thunder and lightning all over you. You think it's just you? This is what requirements do. They change. And they change for everybody all the time. And that's a very good thing. And the reason is the change in the requirements is what keeps everybody employed. Everybody on this webcast would not have a job, myself included, by the way, if requirements were static. And here's why. Because if requirements were static, somebody somewhere, somewhere would have written the code once and that'd be good. And that's it. And they wouldn't need us. The change in the requirements is what keeps all of us employed. But it's not actually a curse. It's a blessing. It's a fantastic thing. And here's why. There's so few of us and so many of them. As a result, the more the change in the requirement happens, the higher the demand for our services. And with higher demand comes better compensation and benefits. And last time I checked, those are very good things. And so we have something that is a very good thing, a blessing, and you got to call it a curse. This is very typical of human beings. Human beings always resent the hand that feeds them. The hand that feeds you is called change, and you resent it. Now, there's another layer here why you learn to resent it. You always try and do a very watered-down version of what I'm proposing here. You try and discern the requirements to the best of your ability, and then you design against it. And then what happens is the requirement change. And when the requirements change, you have to change your design. And we just discussed that changing the design of the system once you've already built it is incredibly expensive. And as far as you're concerned, is painful. And you do not like pain. And so you have learned to equate the change in the requirement with pain. Every time requirements changed, it inflicted pain on you. And as a result, you absolutely hate it and try and convince customers, no, let's not change this and it's not good for you and so on. The solution for this is simple. Now, before I say the solution, you have to realize there's a fundamental cognitive dissonance here because on one hand, we have something which is admittedly very good, a blessing. On the other hand, it's painful and you learn to resent it. Whenever something has this duality to it, you have to resolve it. You can't just succumb to it. So the solution is so simple, it has eluded almost everybody in the industry their entire career. The solution is never design against the requirements. That's it. It's a very simple solution. And your head just exploded. What do you mean never design against the requirements? In fact, all you've seen is design against the requirements. Every project you were part of, everybody designed against the requirements. And then we all try and say, is it 1.2.3 versus this user story versus that? What? And then when you try and maximize the adherence to it in the code. Well, whenever you do that, you're maximizing your pain because the one thing we know is that those requirements are going to change, which is actually a very good thing. But then if you code it, you would maximize your pain. What's the solution? I already told you. Never design against the requirements. Now, I'm saying these things, and that sentence simply does not compute in your head. Why? Because all you have seen your entire career is designing against the requirements. Now, there's a saying, when all you have is a hammer, everything looks like a nail, even if it's your toes. You spent your entire career banging on your toes, and then you wonder why the toes are hurting. Now, let me demonstrate the futility of trying to design against the requirements. Suppose you show up on a project, and on day one of the project, somebody gives you a book with 100 or 200 or 300 use cases. Now, a decent system could have 300 use cases. It's not unheard of. And suppose all the use cases are beautifully specced in activity diagrams graphically. And here, I give you the book. My question to you is, can you trust it? And it's laughable to propose that you would trust it, because nobody in the history of the world has ever had enough time to beautifully spec 300 use cases on day one of the project. Suppose I do give you a set of 300. Are you going to be surprised to learn the real number is 330? You missed a few. Could be. Absolutely. And suppose I give you a book with 300 use cases, but the real number is actually 200. There's lots of duplicates. Could be. Absolutely. Well, you know, if you are going to design against the requirements, you'll be doing 50% more work. That's not a good thing. And suppose I give you a book with 300 use cases, but there's lots of mutually exclusive requirements in there. Could be. Yes, of course. You will never be able to deliver on that system. And so, even if I do give you a book with 300 use cases, and there's no duplicates, and there's no missing requirements, and there's no mutually exclusive requirements, it would be no good, because those 300 are actually going to change. And in the future, you're going to have new requirements that you can't even think about today. And current requirements, which are absolutely pivotal, are going to be thrown out because a regulator doesn't allow it anymore. And so, if I give you a book with 300 use cases on day one of the project, you know what I actually gave you? I gave you a steaming pile of manure. That's what I gave you. Why do you treat it as gospel? Now, suppose I'm looking at your entire software development effort as a black box, and I got something coming into it, which says the requirements, and I got something coming out of it, which is your code. And if we agree that requirements are actually garbage, and I feed the garbage into the machine, what comes out on the other side is? And now you understand why your code was always garbage. I know this is harsh reality to come to terms with, but it had to be so. If you fed it garbage, you got garbage coming out. Now, the notion of GIGO, of garbage in, garbage out, is probably not new to anybody on this call. And that, from a cognitive perspective, is very interesting, because on one part of your brain, you stored the information that there's garbage in, garbage out. You knew about it. It's not news to anybody. On the other hand, you knew the requirements were garbage, and yet you tried to design against them and code it. And how could these two mutually exclusive concepts reside side by side in your head? I do not know. It's like there's some kind of a cognitive dissonance, a short in your head. What's the solution? I already told you, never design against the requirements. And even though I managed to prove to you the futility of designing against the requirements, if you were to go back to your machines right now, you will be designing against the requirements. And the reason is, that's all you know how to do. And now it's even worse. Now you know it's wrong, and you're still going to do it. Why? Because when all you have is a hammer, everything looks like a nail. It's all you've ever seen. So let's start digging out of this hole. The first thing you need to do is define the goal, the mission. The mission of every software system is to satisfy all requirements. Let's pass the word all. All means present and future, known and unknown. That's where the bar is set. Nothing less will do. And here's why. If you don't satisfy all requirements, then sometime in the future, a new requirement will come along and invalidates your system, and invalidates your design. So by definition, the only thing that we'll do is satisfying all requirements, present and future, known and unknown. That is where the bar is set, and nothing less will do. Now, immediately you're rebelling against me. You're saying, but how could I know the future? And how could I know what I don't know? That just doesn't make any sense. Well, you're just not thinking it through. So let's start thinking it through. Suppose I do give you a book with 300 use cases on day one of the project. You can't really trust it. It's basically garbage. And that is really, really bad news. And you will never be able to trust it. But there is a silver lining to this cloud. Suppose I do give you a book with 300 use cases. My real question is the following. Are all of those use cases distinct and unique? And the answer is no. Most of the use cases are variation of other use cases. I have the happy case, the sad case, the incomplete case, the case we just are doing for that customer over there. So now let's separate the use cases into two types. Let's call the first type core use cases. Core use cases represent the essence of the system, the essence of the business. The other type of use cases is fluff. Fluff is all the variation of the core use cases. Now, the core use cases represent the essence of the system. And it turns out that the essence of the system hardly ever changes. For example, the essence of the software system of Federal Express is to ship packages. Now, Federal Express has always been shipping packages, and in the foreseeable future would always ship packages. Now, is it impossible that in the future, Federal Express is going to evolve into ballistic missile control? Now, it's not impossible, but how likely, and are likely to happen anytime soon? So the observation here is that businesses hardly ever change their nature. And when they do change their nature, they do it at glacial pace. And so the core use case presents the essence of the business. The fluff is what keeps changing. Now, let us try and quantify how many core use cases you have in your system. Now, I don't know anything about your system. So when dealing with this kind of uncertainty, we can use an order of magnitude estimation. So let's try and agree what is the order of magnitude of how many core use cases you actually have. Is it more like 1, 10, 100, 1,000, 10,000, 100,000? And I'm only asking you to pick one order of magnitude. Which one is it going to be? Well, most people I ask this question to choose either 1 or 10. Nobody says we have 100 core use cases. Now, it turns out that the right answer is always 1. It can never be 10. And the reason is, reflect on your system right now, back in the office, and count how many truly distinct things you do that represent the essence of the system. You're not gonna get 10, you're gonna get 2 or 3. In fact, we find the number 2 or 3 to be very typical of many systems. Sometimes we see 4, very rarely we see 5. I've only seen 6 once. Now, what does it mean I've only seen 6 once? At IDesign, I've lost count of how many systems we designed over the years. It's in the many hundreds, and I've only seen 6 once, and it was a monster system that I designed for one of the largest companies in the world, a company you all know because you have its products in home. And it had 40 services supporting the entire IT infrastructure of the business in 4 continents, 24/7, catering for 120,000 users. And you know what? Then you get 6, but it wasn't even 6 because it was actually a system of systems. So most systems are going to have maybe even 1, 2, or 3. Now, it doesn't matter if it's 3 or 4, in order of magnitude, it's still 1. Now, finding the core use case is often an iterative process on its own because you will hardly ever have the core use case as an explicit use case. 1.2.3, this is the core use case. Core use cases are always an abstraction of other use cases. And since you're never going to get them explicitly, you have to go and hunt for them. So of course it takes time. Now you can do it iteratively with the marketing people. You can say, look, you gave me this requirement spec, support of this requirement spec, I'm only doing one thing. Which one should it be? And they say, what do you mean just one? It's okay, calm down. We're going to do all of it plus much more. But suppose I'm only doing one thing. Which one is it? They say 4.5.6. Okay, so maybe that's a core use case. Maybe it's not. And you give me another one. At this point, they will say 1.2.3, except that will be a variation of 4.5.6, meaning they give you a variation of a core use case. Why? Because that is such a core use case They give you a variation. You say, oh, no, don't waste a bullet on that one. Give me something totally unique, totally different. And they would say 7.8. By the time you're asking for the third of the fourth that's stuttering, they'd say, well, maybe that one. You're not going to get more than three or maybe four. So it's a very, very small set. Okay. So now, let's define the mission of the architect. As a software architect, you need to discover the smallest set of building blocks that you can put together to satisfy each of the core use cases. Since all the other use cases are a variation of the core use cases, what they actually represent is a different interaction between those building blocks, not a different decomposition thereof. So now when the requirements change, your design does not. This is such a fundamental observation, I'm going to say the whole thing again. You must discover the smallest set of building blocks that you can put together to satisfy each of the core use cases. Since all the other use cases are variation of the core use cases, what they represent is a different interaction between your building blocks, not a different decomposition thereof. So now when the requirements change, your design does not. And I call this idea composable design. Think about what I just said to you. It's a simple, simple idea. You need to come up with a smaller set of building blocks to satisfy the core use cases. And that's basically all you have to do. Everything else is fluff. And this simple idea has eluded almost everybody their entire career in the software industry. It's literally the missing piece that people do not have. Now, I'll tell you a story here. I mentioned to you that in the late 90s, I was the chief software architect of a Fortune 100 company in Silicon Valley. And so once or twice a year, I had to go and do a presentation to the board on what the corporate software body was doing. And I remember doing the presentation once, and one of the board members were pushing me around, and he was saying, so this so-called architecture of yours, how long will it be good for? And I guess he was expecting me to say 3 years, 4 years, whatever, because all they've seen is people after 4 years or so trying to do a new system. And I said to him, look, the answer I really want to give you is forever. And, you know, that sounds like very presumptuous and arrogant. What do you mean forever? And so I said, look, forever is really a long time. Maybe over the millennials, the company will evolve into ballistic missile control. And that could happen. Probability is not zero. But I'm willing to put my name next to one human generation or 20 years. So this architecture will be good for 20 years. Ah, 20 years, so audacious. 2 years ago, I conducted the Architects Masterclass in California. And I had the composable design is part of the Architects Masterclass. And after this slide, somebody comes to me, and he is a director of IT from the old company. And he says to me, we're still using your architecture. And I was smiling because it's been 20 years since I made that statement to the board. So was I surprised? No. Was I gratified? Of course. Now, next is we have to dive slightly deeper into the definition of the mission statement. I said you have to come up with a smaller set of building blocks. Now, why smaller set? You're in the business of doing less work, not more work. And so less is more when it comes to architecture. If you implement less blocks, more power to you. Now, suppose I give you a book with 300 use cases. The most minimalistic design is one giant block that does it all. You cannot have a smaller set of building blocks and one giant block. The problem is, it's a giant monolith of doom because the internal complexity in such a beast is such that you can never actually figure it out. So we have learned the hard way as an industry, this is not a good design, even though it minimizes the number of blocks. But if I give you a book with 300 use cases, we could also come up with 300 blocks, one for each. Now, that is also a bad design. And the reason is, the integration complexity of such a system is astronomical. Now, note that both in the case of the one giant thing and 300 things, you're actually designing against the requirements. In the case of the one big thing, you're saying it does it all. Why? Because I say so. In the case of the 300 little things, you map one for one with the requirements or the sticky notes. And so that's also designing against the requirements. And we just discussed it's not a good design. The sum between 1 and 300 is your number. Let's again use order of magnitude to qualify how many components we're going to need. So it's more like 1, 10, 100, 1,000. Well, 1 is not a good order of magnitude. And also 100 is not, because we know 100 is like 300. So the real answer here is 10. So we're talking about the 10 blocks. Now it could be 12, it could be 13, it could be 20. It doesn't matter if it's 12 or 20, in order of magnitude, it's still 10. And so it's not a large set. Call it about a dozen or so, maybe 10. Now, the reason you don't need the hardened components has to do with combinatorics. Remember that the product of the required behavior is the composition of those boxes, or basically the interaction between them. Now, if you only have 2 or 3 components, there's not enough combinations. There's maybe 6 possible combinations. So the number of possible combinations is on the order of the factorial of the components. Now, by the time I have 10 or 12 components, the factorial of 10 is bazillion. And you're not going to get bazillion use cases. By the time you have 20 components, you have enough combinations to name every atom in the solar system or something. It's a ridiculous number of combinations. And this is, by the way, assuming that you're not actually allowing partial sets or repetitions. If you're allowing partial sets and repetitions, it's way more than the factorial. And so somewhere around 10, the number of possible combinations explodes so much, you're basically good forever or until the business changes its nature, which hardly ever happens. And that's why 10 is a good number. Now, composable design is how everything is put together. This idea is not specific to software. Everything around you is built using composable design. For example, the laptop I'm doing the webcast on right now has about 10 components. I'm not talking about individual transistors. I'm talking about components: CPU, hard drive, bus, memory, graphic card, about 10. Your car has about 10 components: engine block, gearbox, chassis, water pump, about 10. Your body is about 10 components. 2 kidneys, 1 liver, 1 heart, 1 spleen, okay, about 10. Everywhere around you, you will see the number 10. And the reason is the economic pressures that come out of evolutionary processes. Meaning, it doesn't matter if it's an artificial entity like a laptop or like your body, there is no economic sense in one hand in building extra components that are actually not needed, because then the competitors are going to be cheaper and drive you out of business. On the other hand, you can't go into the market half-baked, because then you will not survive. And as a result, doesn't matter if it's a laptop or the human body, these things have evolved to have the smallest minimal set, and we've just discussed that it's about 10. In fact, the human body is an interesting example here. And the reason is that if you look at the architecture of the human body of Homo sapiens, that design was put forward on the plains of Africa about 200,000 years ago. Now, I'm pretty sure that being a software architect wasn't part of the spec at the time. And yet, I'm quite capable of performing that function. Now, for most people, that would not make any sense. If you were to ask a software developer to design one software legend, me, they would design against the requirements. They would look at everything I need to do, and there would be a box. There would be a box, write a book, drive to the airport, conduct a masterclass, design a system, whatever it is. Or maybe to do some kind of crazy domain, meaning your domain as a business owner, your domain as an architect, your domain as a husband, and so on and so forth. But you know what? I look at my body. I don't have a box called write a book or conduct a webcast. So how could I possibly use the same design as a pre-Neolithic hunter-gatherer and be quite successful? Well, the reason is, while I'm using the same components as a pre-neolithic hunter-gatherer, I'm putting those components together in different ways. It's composable design. Oh, incidentally, the core use case hasn't changed. There's only one core use case, which is survive. Now, there's something far more profound about what I showed you so far about composable design. When you come up with the smallest possible set of building blocks that you can put together to satisfy any of the use cases, what happens now is when the use case change, you take your existing components and you don't have a different architecture, you just put them together in different ways. And that enables you to very quickly respond to changes in the marketplace. The ability to respond quickly to changes in the marketplace is the essence of agility. Everybody has heard about the word agile. Everybody fails to deliver on it. Why? Because they design against the requirements. And when you design against the requirement, you maximize pain. You maximize the cost of what it takes to comply with changes to the business. What I showed you is the essence of agility. It's how you be agile. It's how you become agile. Most people equate agile with the ritual, the process, the sticky board, the stand-up meeting, the band. All of these things are the ritual. They are not the essence. You can absolutely do all the rituals and be unable to quickly respond to changes in the marketplace. What I showed you is the essence of agility, and you can, by the way, don't have to do any of the rituals. It is the essence of agility. Now, if you want to do the rituals, go for it. You can absolutely transcribe in user stories how you're going to, what is required behavior, and then go about and implement the user story using the components of composable design. Now, whether or not you do the ritual has nothing to do with the essence. It is absolutely astonishing that in the name of agility, people have guaranteed the lack of agility because they're designed against the requirements. But you know, that's what people always do. Can you please explain to me, how do you get from love thy neighbor and turn the other cheek to the Spanish Inquisition? And I'm sure they thought they were very devout, but I'm missing a few steps there. Now, once we understand the concept of composable design, I want to take it to a completely different place. So if we look at this diagram here, we understand the concept of composable design, but let's talk about value. Where is the value here? Well, look at marketing. Marketing is very valuable. Convincing people to cough money at you, super valuable. There are requirements, very valuable. What is the thing we can actually get away with? Very valuable. Describing the required behavior, super valuable. Architecture, smaller set of components you can put together, satisfy all, okay, very valuable. STD, here's the design that we're gonna use, and here's the third parameter, and so on. Validating the design, super valuable. All of these things are very valuable. What about code? Well, done this way, coding is low added value. And the reason it's low added value is because coding is mechanical. Meaning, it doesn't take much smarts now. If you got the right decomposition, if you document the interaction diagram and the STD, coding is mechanical. And therefore, coding is low added value. Now, most people would disagree that coding is low added value because for most people, all they have for software development effort is the coding block. As a result, by definition, all the values in that box. Now, I completely agree that done this way, all the values in the code, I propose you don't do it that way. If you do it this way, coding becomes mechanical. And if coding is mechanical, why not even have a machine do it? And if we have a machine do it, we are going to completely transform software development. And the reason is, what you actually see in front of you is a software factory. It even looks like a factory assembly line. Now, you all heard the term software factory, but never quite knew what it meant. What you see here is an industrialized approach for developing software. Now, Today's software is done in a pre-industrialized way. It is as if it's the 18th century. Every software system is done by hand. Every software system is a one-off. Nothing is interchangeable. Nothing is reusable. It requires experts for doing even the most trivial things. That is a pre-industrialized approach. Now, what we had with the Industrial Revolution is instead of needing master experts like James Watt to do something, we can have regular factory workers, but they're working in the context of the factory producing a lot of added value out of simple, repeatable, mundane steps. And that's the essence of industrialization. Now, if we're going to have this, we're going to experience the Industrial Revolution in software. Today, software is incredibly labor intensive. It requires an army of ants pouring on the code and maintaining it. Why? Because the complexity is insane. Everybody's running against the requirements. But if you start doing it the way I propose you do it, and by the way, the IDesign customers that are working this way report unbelievable level of customer satisfaction, retention, quality, reduction in cost, and all of these things, just like producing things industrially. My question to you, are we going to need same, more, or fewer developers? Well, let's look at the Industrial Revolution. Before the Industrial Revolution, 97% of the people had to work the fields. After the Industrial Revolution, 3% have to work the fields. Now, the Industrial Revolution did not eliminate farmers. It just drastically reduced the demand for farmers. We're all going to die without farmers, but we don't need as many as we used to in the past. And so if we're going to experience this, what would be the effect on demand for developers? And I think you all suspect that the effect is going to be a drastic reduction in demand for developers. So I believe that this is the future. Now, it's just my opinion here. I can't give you a hard number on this, but that's what it feels like. Now, if this is what's coming, you need to become very good at running this machine. The fact that we don't have good tools that do all of the parts here yet, it doesn't mean that you shouldn't become very good at doing it, preparing yourself for the moment that happens. And so the next question is, when do you think that would actually happen? Okay, so does it feel like it's a second, a minute, an hour, a day, a week, a month, a year, a decade, a century, a millennia? Well, pick one order of magnitude. And is it more like a month, a year, a decade? I don't think anybody said a month, and I don't think anybody said a century. So maybe he said a year, maybe he said a decade. In career terms, this is around the corner. Unfortunately, that is actually wrong. And the reason is, today we have AI. Could we use AI to build these workflows of interacting those components together? In fact, that will feed into the AI the requirements. We'll use machine learning to devise solutions. Now, even if you have 10 components, there's a bazillion possible combinations. Nobody's going to sit there and try it. But for a computer, it's called Thursday afternoon. They can do in one afternoon all the combination. In fact, they can do simulation, and many combinations wouldn't make much sense. And so you can actually have some kind of Bayesian logic and say, well, we never have the database called the client, so we never have to pursue those passes. And maybe run all of them in parallel and see what works the best. And how far are we from that happening? Well, that's actually in our past. Here is an article from 3 years ago. This is a product at Microsoft where it's a clickbait that the AI is stealing from other programs. What they did here is they taught an AI to solve simple programming tasks, or solve simple requirements by going to Stack Overflow and copying and pasting code, since this is what most developers are doing anyway. It's not a big stretch. And this was happening 3 years ago. And look at the pullout out of the article. It could allow non-coders to simply describe an idea for the program and let the system build it, of course. Here is another article. This is from 2 years ago. There's a startup in Palo Alto in California that have an AI that codes, and there's no pullout, but there is a highlighted here. It's how to build different kinds of components and how to weave them together, assembling building blocks of ready-made code. Sounds like composable design. A core set of building blocks that makes it super fast to build a wide array of software. What? That's like a sentence out of my book, and it's a year before my book was even published. So do you think it's going to take a decade? So I think this is our future. Now, what this means is that the Terminator is coming for software developers. Now, it's just my opinion here. I could be wrong here, but it's literally is already happening. And that means that you need to take a long, hard look at the rest of your career and decide what you want to specialize in. Specializing in splunking into code and moving semicolons is not a good career prospect because the Terminator is coming. You know, if the Terminator is coming and your name is Sarah Connor, that's not a good day. On the other hand, this whole thing is predicated on nailing the architecture correctly. AI is not worth anything unless you have the correct architecture. So knowing how to do that will give you not just a good career path, but enormous demand. Look at what the impact the Industrial Revolution had, not on farmers, but on engineers. Before the Industrial Age, we didn't need that many engineers. In the Industrial Age, we need a lot of engineers to manage the machines and the factories. And so we're going to see an increased demand for architects and decreased demand for developers, and probably in a non-linear way. So you need to decide which side of this divide you want to spend the rest of your career on. And let me end here with some resources for you. There's much more on what we discussed today on the IDesign website. You can get the slides on the /missing piece URL. What I described to you today is chapter 4 in my book, Writing Software. The book discusses how to go about building such system. Today we discussed just what you need to do. I didn't quite go into how you need to do it. The book describes how you need to do it, not just from the system design perspective, meaning what, how do you build architectures that yield for composable design, but what should the project look like that supports composable design? What should the project design look for? There's also information here on the architects masterclasses that I conduct. This year we're going to conduct it once in California, the Architects Masterclass and the Project Design Masterclass. So we're right on the 60 minutes mark. So let me finish it right here.
Thank you so much, Juval. That was incredible. We have a few great questions, so we have about 15 minutes scheduled, and we'll see what we can get through. One question I think is a good start. How can developers get architects and the business to buy into the idea of composable design in an enterprise setting? Do you have any advice for that?
Give me just a second. I'm still dealing with the,
sure,
the issues.
Okay, so I switched microphones as well, so there should be a change there. So is that question typed in the chat window somewhere?
Yeah, so David Mills asked this question. It's the most recent one. So asking about how do you get everyone on board, including the business?
Okay, so enterprise this thing. Question is already wrong. How do you get everyone on board? You will never get everyone on board. Okay, progress is not done by you convincing all the lemmings not to jump off the cliff and then they're all marching to prosperity. The world has never worked this way, not even 1 second. Progress is made in spite of the lunatics and the lemmings that are hell-bent on jumping off the cliff. Every progress, every invention was done by those that went against the stream. In addition, you don't care about other people. You only care about number one, you. You need to fix your career. You need to future-proof it. The others, they can jump off the cliff. So you don't need to convince anybody. If you are convinced, then you do it. And everybody else, well, they can jump off the cliff. And unless you adopt this kind of a mindset, nothing else in your life would work as well. You need to fix yourself. You clean up your room first before you clean up the world. So get really, really good at doing this. And then you let the results speak for themselves. And you know what? Nobody can argue with success. And once you succeed, nobody's going to slay the goose that laid the golden eggs. And maybe a few of the others are going to come to you and say, how come it's working for you and it's not working for me? Can you show me what's wrong, what's different? And then you can talk to them. But those would be maybe 2 or 3% of the masses.
Great. Okay. And on that note, you know, we have all of the audience here today. Maybe they're really excited about what they heard and they want to go in tomorrow and start taking action based off of your recommendations. What do you think would be a good first step, Juval?
First of all, take a walk out, get some oxygen. because what I described today is so heterodoxy. It's so against what everybody is ingrained to. You will have to go through a Kobler-Ross cycle. The Kobler-Ross cycle is the grief cycle, right? First there's denial, then there's anger, then there's sadness and pain and acceptance, right? There's the cycle. And your brain would rebel against what I said, because you would have to come to terms with the realization that every software system you touched in the past, you destroyed, that it was all garbage. These are not easy realizations. So first, just go through a quick Kobler-Ross section cycle, go through that. And then the easiest simple thing is to get a copy of Writing Software, where I lay it out for you, and I even talk about how to go about providing the message. And then you start a journey. And it turns out that to become really, really good at it is a holistic approach, because it's not just knowing how to do the design. It's knowing how to do the project to support it. It's knowing how to become a good leader, a technical leader, a team leader. And so you need to have all of these aspects patched for you to succeed. And to become good at anything takes time. But you know, Rome wasn't built in a day, and every long journey has the first step. Just start walking, start doing it. Don't wait for somebody to anoint you. Don't wait for somebody to pat you on the shoulder and empower you. Your future is in your hands. Take the first baby steps, read the book. If you can make it into my masterclasses, you can try. My masterclasses get sold out sometimes more than a year or two in advance. And so you can try and get into those, or at least get on the waiting list. And get your thumb out of your mouth and start doing your work.
Great. We had a question that was pretty interesting that came in to the panelists. So Dimitri had this analogy between an engine and a car. An engine is pretty important. He's saying you could take an engine from different models, the Toyota engine, put it in with a Lexus engine, but you wouldn't put a really powerful engine into a small car because there's no need, right? So he's comparing this in software systems. We could easily build one engine for cars, rocket ships, etc. When building software components, how reusable should we make them? If we should strive to have the minimal set of components, would that mean we all strive to have one engine component reused everywhere?
So Dimitri, I disagree with you. And unless we're talking about a complete clone of exactly the same model of a car, the engine is never, ever, ever reusable. The only thing that is truly reusable are things like electrons or nuts and bolts. Components themselves are not reusable, ever. You can never take an engine from a Ford and put it in a Toyota. You can even take a Toyota motor from one truck and put it in another SUV, unless it's exactly the same chassis. The observation here is that the components are not reusable. What is reusable is the interface of the components. Meaning, if I look at your car versus my car, I don't know anything about your car, but I can immediately drive your car. Why? Because the interface to the components of the car, which would be the steering wheel, the shifter, the gas, the pedal, and so on, that interface is reusable between my car and your car, even though the underlying components are not. So whenever you design a system, the reusable element are the interface of the things, not the thing itself. And there's a whole discussion of how do you design reusable interfaces. Appendix B in Writing Software discusses it. We didn't discuss how to design for use at all. I can do a whole other webcast if you're interested on how to design reusable interfaces.
Great. Okay, so reusable interfaces. And let's see, we had another question. Is it possible to migrate an existing enterprise system to a system designed with volatility in mind?
So we didn't discuss volatility at all. And so the focus of today was on what to do. The how to do it is, it turns out that those blocks encapsulate areas of volatility in the system. Now, it doesn't matter if it's an enterprise system or not, since most systems are designed against the requirements, the components in the system are components of functionality, not components of volatility. And so there is no holy water here. You can't take something, sprinkle some holy water and say, you're not a pig, you're a fish. That's just complete nonsense. It's magical thinking, okay? Plus, it contradicts some basic laws of entropy and thermodynamics in the universe, meaning if companies spend sometimes decades doing it wrong, you won't be able to fix it in a few minutes. The blood shed has to be paid with new blood. And so I wish I could give you, oh, yeah, you can just put some ribbon on it and it'll be fine, but you'll be putting lipstick on a pig. Most systems that are so horribly designed need to actually die a horrible, violent death. And then hopefully you're going to have enough funds and stamina to do it right. Now, if you recognize that's the end trajectory and that the system will eventually die, you could preempt it by saying, okay, we are going to develop a new system done correctly on the side. Maybe some components we could somehow shift, maybe some understanding of user experience, maybe some customer database or whatever. And you can perhaps have some kind of a very long, very arduous path for recovery. Now, this is something that is typically so painful. In the absence of a crisis, people are actually not going to do it. So I'm not optimistic about it, but that's what you should be doing.
Great. I think we have time for at least one or two more questions. Glenn Allen had a question about, you know, there's a big movement right now to get everyone into coding. Everyone's going to coding camps, switching their careers to tech. Would you think that this is a bad move? How do you grow your architecture skills? And isn't that just design?
So it turns out that human beings are always reactive as opposed to proactive. Very few human beings are proactive. The status of the industry is such that the horribly designed software systems today create endless demand for developers. Like the joke says, one bad developer creates work for seven other bad developers. All they do is dig a deeper hole, and it creates enormous demand. And that demand is actually artificial, because if they were to do it properly, they would need a fraction of that many developers. Okay, and so what we have here is an army of ants mentality, where you're going to throw armies of ants of developers on a problem and hope it would yield. And under that assumption, all you want to do is create more code monkeys and throw them on the code. That is a reactionary approach. Okay, and incidentally, a similar thing happened just before the Industrial Revolution. The Industrial Revolution took place in the 19th century. Was precipitated by the agricultural revolution of the 18th century. Not many actually know about what happened in England in the early 1700s, but Gertrude Tool, his automatic spreader, and the automatic hoe, and they were all drawn by oxes and horses. And there was something there also with crop rotation. They basically tripled the production of food, which created enormous demand for farmers. So it turns out just before the Industrial Revolution, which basically eliminated farmers, there was a spike in demand for farmers. Okay, that's what I think about training masses to code. It's complete dead end, it's reactionary, and it's not gonna do a damn good, because the complexity is non-linear, right? There's an upper limit of how big could any team be before it stops being effective. So the fact that we're going to have millions of more developers, it's not going to help me with my garbage software today, because it's too complex anyway for me to have any team making sense of it. Look, I'm too old to become anything besides honest about these things. I'm not going to try and sugarcoat it.
And do you have any suggestions for someone who wants to train more in their software architecture skills?
Yes. You need to make a strategic commitment for it. I already talked to you about the easy step. The easy steps, which you should do, I'm not discounting it, read my book, attend my classes. But once you're on a path of an architect, you're on a strategic path as opposed to a tactical path. Life is full of tactical decisions. Tactical decision is where you live, who do you work for, to some extent even who are your friends. Strategic decisions, you actually make very few. What to study, who to marry, whether or not to have kids. you only make a handful of strategic decisions. If you run your life correctly, you make a few good strategic decisions, and then all the tactics is run against the strategic to serve the strategic, okay? So once you understand that it's a strategic pass, you say, okay, so I know how to do this. What are the opportunities for doing it correctly? Do I have to move? Well, you know, if you're in the boonies, you probably don't have too many opportunities for companies that need this kind of architecture. Now, even a startup needs it, but they're not going to recognize it. So we're now looking at what are the set of companies that experience a high level of pain and have already realized the bad way, and now they're opening for the good way. Well, you know, maybe you have to move. Who is going to mentor you? Well, even if you go to a company that recognizes you need to do a good job, and they don't know how to do it, but they say, okay, here's the keys, you do it, you're not going to succeed. Is there anybody there to mentor you? So it turns out by the time you start putting all those filters, those opportunities are there. And as a result, it takes time to find the right opportunities. So maybe it will take you 2 years to find the opportunities. You don't just go and sign up with the first company that offers you the position of an architect. No, it has to be perfect. And even then, that's just the first phase, because at the beginning, you want to learn how to do it right. So you want to actually look for the company that has the cleanest environment you can possibly find. Unfortunately, in a clean environment, there's very little difference you can actually make. And so after you learn how to do it right, you want to go and look for a messy environment, because then you can fix it. And then you get another feather on your cap. So there's a whole discussion on what is the career planning of an architect. By the way, I discussed that in the Architects Masterclass. And there's a whole, and it turns out the career planning of an architect is very different than the career planning of a developer.
Great. Do you have any reference material or resources for writing effective use cases, or did you include any of those in the, would you find that in your book somewhere in the slides?
So I try to avoid anything to do with development process. I did not want to write a book on development process. I wanted to write a book on design. Now, obviously some process seeps into it, it's unavoidable. So I have a few examples. I have a long case studies, almost 40 pages, and I go into very detail as to what the use cases look like. And you can use that as a model for what use cases should look like, but it's not an overall guide of how to write requirements. Because remember, requirements are on the business domain, they're not in the software domain. If you're looking for books, go to Amazon, type software requirements, and I think the best author's name is Weinstein, and he wrote a few books in the 70s and the 80s, which are considered to this day to be the absolute classics on how to write requirements.
Perfect. Well, it looks like we are out of time today, but I've enjoyed this so much, Juval. Thank you so much for sharing with us today. It was really incredible, and thank you to all of our audience for being here and joining us as well.
Excellent. Thank you for the opportunity. Maybe I'll see you next time.
Yes. Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye.